farming. So I will present in this paper. This is part of my PhD dissertation in Berkeley. So the title of the presentation is The Response of Salaried Workers to the Personal Income Tax, and I will be showing some evidence using regressions from the continuity design from Argentina. So the big question behind the paper is, how do taxes affect the labor supply of wage earners? And of course, this question is not new. The response of wage earners to the personal income tax has been of interest to economists and policymakers for a long time. And the magnitude of this response is of critical importance for tax and transfer policies and welfare analysis. However, I think that there is no consensus yet about the response of, in particular, wage earners to tax rates in general. Empirical estimates range from no effect to very sizable responses, and there is this paper by Saez and co-authors 2012, in which they summarize the most recent evidence. Moreover, most of the literature is based on developed countries, so it's good to have papers showing some evidence for developing countries like Argentina or, for example, average for Ecuador. So what we do in this project, we exploit a natural experiment in Argentina in the period 2013-2016 that introduced a discontinuity in the income tax. The reform, in August 2013, the president passed a decree that exempted from the personal income tax a group of workers, salaried workers, approximately 1.4 million workers, that were below an earning threshold. And this was in place for 2.5 years, so it was between 2013 to 2016. The key part of this natural experiment is that the tax cut was based on earnings accrued prior to the reform, so before 2013. So workers were not able to manipulate earnings to avoid the tax. This was an unexpected reform, and it affected differentially what would otherwise be comparable workers around the discontinuity. So we use this exogenous variation to estimate earnings responses of salaried workers using administrative data from Argentina. And this is a contribution. We use a regressions continuity design, which is going to overcome identification issues that have flagged previously. So as a preview of the findings, the first thing I show in the first stage is that the tax cut created a large and salient discontinuity in tax liabilities. For example, the marginal tax rates for the group of workers around the discontinuity went from 20% to zero. And for example, annual tax savings as a share of gross earnings, was about 10%. So this, we are talking about a lot of money. However, in the second stage, we show that salaried workers didn't react to the tax in terms of real responses. So we don't see any discontinuity in earnings around the threshold after 2.5 years. So let me start the presentation of this. The next step is to discuss a little bit the institutional context so that you understand how the income tax works in Argentina. We have a progressive personal income tax schedule with 7 brackets. Now they made a reform, we have 8, but in this period we had 7. Brackets and marginal tax rates ranging from 9% to 35%. So we have here, this is the classic table in which I show the 7 brackets and the marginal tax rate for each of these categories. In practice, employers must withhold the income tax for employees from their monthly paychecks. The amount to withhold depends on their taxable income, so this is very standard. From your gross income, you have to subtract the social security contributions, then you can subtract personal exemptions, for example, spouse and children. This is a very important part. And other minor general deductions, for example, mortgage interest. Another important thing to keep in mind is that in Argentina, as well as in many developing countries, the personal income tax is borne by relatively high income people. So let me motivate a little bit the reform that we exploit. There are 4 key facts that have characterized the evolution of the personal income tax in the last years. The first one is that this schedule here was fixed in nominal terms in the last decade, in the last 15 years. The second fact is that we had huge inflation. We still have, on average, 27 to 30% yearly. So you can imagine it's a mess. A lot of people started paying taxes because the third part, nominal earnings were adjusted every year, roughly following inflation. And exemptions, spouse and children deductions, were adjusted regularly and usually behind the average increase in wages. So because of this bracket creep, a lot of people started paying the income tax, and moreover, a lot of people were facing the top marginal tax rate, and they had different earnings profile. So the income tax lost a lot of progressivity in the last years, and to alleviate the increasing tax burden on wage earners, in 2013 the government implemented a large and salient tax cut to alleviate this burden, and this was very convenient for the government because it was right before legislative elections, so it was also like a populist movement. So let me explain the reform. The reform is pretty standard. It was announced in August 28th, but the key fact, as I mentioned before, is that the reform was based on your earnings prior, before August 28th. So workers were not able to manipulate or to adjust their earnings to avoid or to be part of this tax cut. So what the reform did was to split the universe of workers into three groups. The most important part is the first part of the second timeline is the first part. Let me explain this in this slide. So the rule was the following. To be tax exempt from the income tax, you have to take your monthly earnings from January to August 2013, so before the announcement, and if your highest gross earnings was below 15K, then you were tax exempt from the income tax from that point onwards, regardless of what you make afterward. And this is the group that I will focus today. This is the most important one. Then there was a 20% increase in personal exemptions if you were between 15 and 25K, and then if you were above 25K, you continue paying the income tax normally. So you can see that the reform introduces discontinuity at 15K and 25K. I will show you some graphs for the first threshold, so for 15. The key fact of this reform is that it affected differentially what would otherwise be comparable workers around the threshold. So an example, so that this is very clear, if you were earning below 15K prior to the reform, and after that you get a promotion and you earn 20,000 pesos after the reform, then you don't have to pay the income tax. But if you were earning 16,000 pesos, then you continue paying the income tax. Okay? The empirical strategy, the regression of interest is on the left-hand side, we have reported income. Remember that this is third-party reported. And we want to see what is the effect of taxes on reported income. Of course, a standard OLS regression is going to be biased, and what the literature has done so far is to try to find some smart instruments or use variation from reforms. So what we do instead in this paper, we use a regression continuity design, which is going to overcome identification difficulties because, as you know, this is the most internally valid strategy. And the basic idea, I won't show you the equation that we run, but the basic idea is to plot average outcomes around the discontinuity. In the first stage, the important thing to show is that the whether tax burden changes sharply around the discontinuity. So we should see that people to the left are going to pay less taxes than the people to the right. And in the second stage, the relevant question is whether this discontinuity in tax liabilities translates into a discontinuity in labor outcomes after the reform. So the data that we use in this paper is administrative data from the Social Security. The important thing that I want to stress here is that we are not using tax data. We are using data from the Social Security, and this is because we want to see workers paying the income tax and not paying the income tax. So we need both. Another important thing is in the last part of this slide, we can see that the size of the data we have in 2013, there were around 400K private firms and around 6 million private salaried workers, 9 million if we take into account public workers. So we have public and private workers. And remember that this is also only for salaried workers, so we are not, the reform didn't affect self-employed. In this table, what I want to show in the in column number 4, you can see that in the second line, something that I mentioned before is that relatively rich people or high-income people pay the income tax. So we can see that around this continuity, we are talking of people in decile 8 and 9. So this is an identification check. This is the distribution of our running variable. The running variable, remember, is that your highest earnings between January and August 2013. And of course, around the discontinuity, 15 and 25K, it has to be smooth. Otherwise, they would be manipulating the running variable and this wouldn't work. We would be talking about bunching, not an RD. Another important thing from this picture is that the line there that has MNI, this is for minimum non-taxable income. This is the first scheme. And we can see this is consistent with average paper. We can see that for gross earnings, there is no bunching. Okay? So this is already a message, or this is like some evidence that it's hard for salaried workers, it's hard to respond in real terms to the income tax. This is another robustness check. We can see that the distribution of age and gender is balanced around the threshold, and this is for 15K. Then the first stage, we have to show that there is a discontinuity in tax liabilities. So in the plot on the left part of this slide, you can see that the share of, before the reform, the single workers without children were paying around 10% of net earnings in taxes, and then they went from this 10% to zero, so the flat line there. And on the right-hand side, you can see that they went from a 27% marginal tax rate to zero, okay? And because of inflation, you can see that actually the people to the right, they face a higher marginal tax rate after the reform. So the main result in one slide, we can see that what we are plotting here is the average earnings after the reform, so 2 years and a half after the reform. And on the x-axis, what we have is our running variable, so your earnings before the reform. And we can see that around the discontinuity, or around the threshold 15K, there is no discontinuity 2 years and a half after. Okay? So you might wonder, remember that in the literature, they find no effect sometimes, but the standard elasticity is usually low, but in the around 0.2 or 0.1. So if we actually take that elasticity and we do this thought experiment and we simulate what should have been the response, this is what we should have observed with an elasticity of 0.2. So this is a simulation. And we actually observe this, no response. So here we have some numbers for completeness. In this picture, in this table, what we can see is that we are actually measuring precisely zero effect of tax cut on labor supply. So we have no response after 2.5 years. Another question that you might have is, what about other margins? For example, people switching from having positive income to missing or to zero. And we can interpret missing as people going from the formal system to informality, or maybe, I don't know, there could be many reasons, but that's one of the candidates. Another thing that is standard is to study some heterogeneities by firm size, gender, and sector, the sector where you work. And finally, some could argue that this was not indeed salient, but I'm going to argue that it was indeed salient. So the fraction of missing, and we take this missing as a proxy for former workers dropping out, we can see that again, around the discontinuity, we don't see anything going on there. What about the heterogeneities? We can see here that female and male didn't respond differently. Again, this is for private workers. Then on the two bottom graph, we have for unionized workers and non-unionized. We have very strong labor unions in Argentina, and we don't see any response either. Finally, other things that we have tried by firm size, I can show you this if you are interested later, by age group, sectors, labor unions, we didn't find anything. So this is a very robust zero result. Finally, I would like to finish this presentation by talking about saliency. Maybe people can argue that this was not indeed a salient reform, but first of all, the income tax is very salient. In Argentina, people are complaining always about this. They complain about many things, but they also complain about the income tax. You can actually see in your paycheck if you are paying the income tax, if you hit the first kink. I will show you some anecdotal evidence from newspapers and Google Trends and from a paycheck. So first thing, this is from newspapers. This was the top two pictures. This is the newspaper of the day the reform was announced, or one day after the reform was announced. And we can see that this is the front page of the main newspaper, two main newspapers in Argentina. It says only people earning more than 15K are going to pay the income tax. And then in the bottom article, it says that this decree was creating an unequal treatment between salaried workers. So this was very salient. It was in the news everywhere. Then, if we look at these Google Trends, people were actively searching for the word minimum non-taxable income. So they wanted to know whether they were going to pay the income tax or not. And this was the day the reform was, the month the reform was announced, we can see a big spike there. And the day, the month the reform was repealed, 2016, we can also see that people were actively searching for this. Finally, this is my favorite part of the presentation. This is evidence, this is one observation in my regression. So this is the paycheck of a salaried worker that was affected by the reform. And we can see here, there are two things to know. The first one, the blue, we can see that this is actually the number that I observe in my data. So I only observe gross monthly earnings. And then you can see that there are two lines that correspond to income tax concepts. The first line says that these guys should have paid 4,000 and a half pesos in income taxes. And the second line, it says that he was benefited by this tax reform, so he doesn't have to pay this income tax. And you can see that this, if we take the ratio, this is a lot of, we are talking a lot about a lot of money. So it was a huge share of this monthly gross salary. So some potential explanations. One is that substitution effect and income effect are opposite each other. That's the theory that labor economists like. Another one is that there is low intensive elasticity of earnings or of gross earnings with respect to marginal tax rates. And in particular, remember that we are talking about high income people here, so this is consistent with other papers talking about this. Another explanation is that there are large adjustment costs, so it takes time to find a new job. Salaried workers don't have a lot of flexibility to adjust hours, so they take a part-time job or a full-time job, and you don't have a lot of flexibility like self-employed people. Finally, and this is also related to average labor, that first mediate tax responses of employees, and it could be hard to coordinate this. In particular, if you have a mix of workers that were affected by the reform and that were not affected, adjusting their gross earnings could be something very difficult to do. So some final remarks. In the first stage, we show that there is a discontinuous change in taxes. However, in the second stage, we show that people didn't react to this. So labor supply of upper wage earners is not responsive, and we think this is striking because the tax cut was large and very saving. This zero result is consistent with some papers in developed countries, Thais in the US, Thais again in Greece, Bastani and Selly for Sweden, and also I should add Albrecht here for Ecuador about his evidence for gross income. This could imply that the cost of rising personal income taxes in Argentina and maybe in other developing countries are not large, at least for intensive margin and upper income earners, and in terms of real responses, not other responses like deductions. The similarity of the income tax in other developing countries and the lack of evidence, as Albert mentioned too, make the topic of this paper a very important venue for future research, and to see, I would like to see what happens in other contexts and in other countries regarding real labor supply responses.